You are listening to a broadcast of the First Congregational United Church of Christ Phoenix.
Good morning, First Church.
Good morning.
Happy Father's Day.
Thank you. Happy Father's Day.
Whether you're a father or not,
we can all be happy about it.
All right. Welcome to our visitors and welcome to the people who are watching us or listening to us on some kind of electronic device out there. We're glad to see you all here today. And please plan to join us after worship for our third Sunday of the month potluck. And today, it's honoring, of course, the June birthdays, and a little extra chance to say Happy Father's Day to the fathers or to the nurturing men in the crowd, and also to introduce our new tenants and friends. I don't like the word tenants. It sounds cold. But anyway, our new people that are going to be using some of our facilities, certainly not new to everybody, Joshua Tree. And I would love all of the Joshua Tree representatives who are in here right now to stand. And no, I will not introduce you by name, but we just want to recognize you. All right. Thank you. And they'll be explaining who they are, what they do, and all of that at the potluck. So you better stay or you won't know. Sunday school is the First Church twist on Vacation Bible School, so all children into Sunday school at 10:30, because there isn't going to be a children's moment. That's my understanding anyway, and if I'm wrong, I apologize in advance. Call to Care Coordinating Council is next week, and we're invited to hear Michael Weekly, Deputy Director of 1 and 10, and he's going to make a presentation about 1 in 10 and what they are doing for homeless LGBTQ youth, as well as what they're doing, lots of things that they're doing to help. And this is a potluck, so those of you who are attending, if you would care to bring some food, it would be most appreciated. Robert provides some, but I know he would appreciate more. And so would the people who might not have enough to eat otherwise. Don't forget, I forgot to wear my button, but there are these big buttons that say something. Where's yours?
I don't have one.
Well, heck, nobody up here has one. Anyway, it's about the AV.
I made a sound investment.
Our AV for, you know, our little booth that's going to be back there, and our screens and the audiovisual equipment, which hopefully will be up and running by the mid-July. The church is still excitedly accepting donations. If you haven't donated yet, please feel free to do so. Okay, Karen Community needs birthday cards. They're the group that sends out birthday cards to all of us. And if you'd like to donate some birthday cards to the cause, that would be appreciated. You could give them to you, to Ms. Kitty. And we're also looking for people who would be willing to maybe pick somebody up and bring them to church, because we have people that aren't here just because they don't have a way to get here. And if you're interested in doing that, you don't have to do it every week. If you can do it every week, great. She's also, the same one, is the one to talk to about that as well. And next Sunday is our immigration welcoming presentation. And I want you to read that one, because I'm not going to read the whole thing to you. And it's I said that next Sunday, but it's two Sundays. It's the 30th. The 23rd is called to care. The 30th is immigration welcoming. So you better just plan to come to church every Sunday for a while, because just a lot of stuff going on. We also, as you can see, are taking donations for Grace Lutheran Church, which is just right around the corner, very close by. And they have ways, I think it's available most of the time, but at least like 3 days a week, where they will give out water,
crackers to help the homeless folks who are out there. And we, and especially in this weather when water is essential to live, we donate to them because we send a lot of the people that come to our doors to them. So this, the water and the snacks are here to be dedicated today, but donations are always welcome, not just right now. What? This Friday?
Movie night.
Oh, it's not in here.
Yes, it is.
Oh, it is. Okay. This coming Friday, which would be the 22nd? Anyway, this coming Friday is movie night. The movie is Amistad. We meet in Libby Parlor, and it's fun. So, and there's no book involved, just a movie. So please plan to come. Debbie had an announcement.
Start out, I want to thank you all for your prayers and your condolences, my sister's passing. Now, on the east wall, the east double doors, there is a blown up one of this. And this is, know your status, get tested for HIV. And MIHA, which is Maricopa Interfaith HIV AIDS Alliance, has teamed up with the Black AIDS Task Force. And on the 27th of June, from 1 to 6, we're offering a free HIV testing event. There was a time when HIV was a death sentence. Think about Magic Johnson. He's still alive and well. Get tested because you can be treated. As of the 23rd of April, 1.1 million people in the United States were living with HIV. One in five, that's 18.1% of all people, are unaware of their infection. This is free. Please come and check and see. Thank you.
Thank you, Debbie. All right, I am almost done. Pastor Wally, you might want to knock about 5 minutes off your sermon because I've been talking so long. But we very importantly have not asked if we have any first-time visitors in our crowd today. Anybody who's here for the very first time. If you do, we have a little gifty for you. Oh, there's one. I see one. Oh, there's another one. And also those little black Ritual of Friendship attendance, whatever you want to call them, pads that look like what Kitty's holding up, that are at the end of your row, if you could please make sure that they get up and down your aisle, because we, so we can see who we are worshiping with in our church family. And we use it to keep track of a lot of things, too. Basically, if you have Verizon phones, we're tapping you, and, you know, a lot of things are going on with our attendance sheets. So be prepared. And I believe, hearing no other announcement requests, that I am finally finished, and we can get around. And we can get to the business of worshiping God. Thank you.
Good morning and happy Father's Day. Oops. All right. Well, we got through that, and happy Father's Day anyway to the fathers and all the nurturers in the group, and I will keep this as brief as possible. Will you join me in the unison centering prayer, which is on the first page of your bulletin? Everyone who thirsts, come to the waters, and you who have no money, come, buy and eat. Why do you spend your money for that which is not bread, and your labor for that which does not satisfy? Incline your ear and come to me. Listen so that you may live. Thank you. join me in the invitation to worship, which is also on the front page of your bulletin. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord.
Our feet are standing within your walls, First Church.
Pray for the work and ministry of this community.
May our worship this day be witness to our desire to love you, O God, in word and deed.
Good morning. Our opening hymn this morning is a new one for our congregation, and it's number 458, and is with most gospel songs. You can go ahead and stand. Thank you, those of you leading the way. As with most gospel songs, the rhythm and the notes on the page are just really suggestions. So have a good time, and don't stress, because I've got a feeling that everything's going to be all right.
Spirit of the living God. Let us pray.
God of compassion, your heart longs for justice in this world. Forgive us when we choose to walk by life on the other side, ignoring those who are wounded and hurt. Our own concerns prevent us from seeing the needs of others. We get so caught up in small concerns of life that we cannot see the big picture. Have mercy upon us, forgive us, and change us to be more like Jesus, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And now, may we share in our own personal reflections and confessions. Our loving God promises us the sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. My dear friends, believe the good news that comes from God. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are God's by grace. We are forgiven. And now, as forgiven and reconciled people, let us share the peace of Christ with those who worship around us. The peace of Christ be with you all.
And also with you.
Welcome to worship at First Congregational United Church of Christ Phoenix, where extravagant welcome is an everyday way of living. This is the church that says, come, be a part of our family. Come be one with God. No matter where you've been in life, there is a place for you here. No matter where you are on your journey, here is a place to rest.
Before
Judy reads from the Hebrew Bible. I notice we still have some kids here, and we are having a full session of the children's hour, and so children are supposed to go directly to that session. So if you have children, you may dismiss them at this time, and throughout the summer we're going to be doing this. So, all right, see you, Anthony.
Okay, and now we will have a reading from the Hebrew Bible, from the first book of Kings, chapter 21, verses 1 through 10. Later, the following events took place. Naboth the Jezreelite had a vineyard in Jezreel, beside the palace of King Ahab of Samaria. And Ahab said to Naboth, "Give me your vineyard, so that I may have it for a vegetable garden, because it is near my house. I will give you a better vineyard for it, or if it seems good to you, I will give you its value in money." But Naboth said to Ahab, "The Lord forbid that I should give you my ancestral inheritance." Ahab went home resentful and sullen because of what Naboth, the Jezreelite, had said to him, for he had said, "I will not give you my ancestral inheritance." He lay down on his bed, turned away his face, and would not eat. His wife Jezebel came to him and said, "Why are you so depressed that you will not eat?" He said to her, "Because I spoke to Naboth the Jezreelite and said to him, 'Give me your vineyard for money, or else if you prefer, I will give you another vineyard for it.' But he answered, 'I will not give you my vineyard.' His wife Jezebel said to him, 'Do you now govern Israel? Get up, eat some food, and be cheerful. I will give you the vineyard of Naboth the Jezreelite.' So she wrote letters in Ahab's name and sealed them with his seal. She sent the letters to the elders and the nobles who lived with Naboth in his city. She wrote in the letters, 'Proclaim a fast and seat Naboth at the head of your assembly. Seat two scoundrels opposite him and have them bring a charge against him, saying, "You have cursed God and the king." Then take him out and stone him to death." Here ends the reading. Whoa.
As Judy mentioned, this is a very cheerful and let me just say before I read the gospel lesson that I fully intended to preach on that text, and I hope I will have opportunity in the future to do so. But I'm going to tell you the reason why I'm preaching on the gospel text this morning.
And this is a wonderful story, and it's a touching story, but it's also one that in its own way is quite troubling. It's a story from the life of Jesus in which Jesus is invited to the house of a Pharisee to probably have dinner or whatever, and a crowd hears about this occasion, and so they gather. Amongst the people who come uninvited is a woman who, as the text puts it, was a sinner. So I want to read what happens on this occasion. "One of the Pharisees asked Jesus to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And a woman in the city who was a sinner, having learned that he was eating in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster jar of ointment. She stood behind him at his feet, weeping, and began to bathe his feet with her tears and to dry them with her hair. Then she continued kissing his feet and anointing them with the ointment. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw it, he said to him, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what kind of woman this is who is touching him, that she is a sinner." Jesus spoke up and said to him, "Simon, I have something to say to you." "Teacher," he replied, "speak." "A certain creditor had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii and the other 50. When they could not pay, he canceled the debts for both of them. Now, which one of them would love him more?" Simon answered, "I suppose the one who had for whom he canceled the greater debt." And Jesus said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning to the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house, you gave me no water for my feet, but she has bathed my feet with her tears and dried them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet with ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which were many, have been forgiven. Hence, she has shown great love. But the one to whom little is given, is forgiven, loves little." Then he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." But those who were at the table with him began to say among themselves, "Who is this man who even forgives sins?" And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." So this ends the reading of the gospel. Well, I'd like to begin by adding my good wishes for all the fathers here and all those who have been fathers in many ways to those who have come into their circle of friendship. Some of you have been, even though you may not be a father biologically, you have given of yourselves to others to mentor them, to share love with them, and to help them along the way. So to all of you, I would like to add my wishes for a happy Father's Day. It's very appropriate that at this time I have come to this moment. I just attended my daughter's graduation last weekend. No more college debts. But it was a proud moment, and it was a wonderful time. She, of course, inherited my wife's intellectual genes and graduated summa cum laude. And so, nevertheless, I am equally proud, even though I had nothing to do with it. But it was a wonderful time to be together with my wife, who came all the way from Hawaii for the occasion, and my daughter and my son, who lives there in the greater Denver area. So it was a proud papa moment for me. I'd like to thank Steve Barrett, who got off his deathbed to come and bring a wonderful sermon and presented a wonderful worship experience for all of you who were here last week. You know, some of you may not know that he literally came out of the hospital to come to this occasion, and after he was done, he had a little relapse and went back into the hospital. I don't know what you all did to him, but
but Steve as well, as you can see, and is present with us this morning in worship. So thanks, Steve, for all you did. Let us pray. Thank you, most gracious God, among whose names we have our Heavenly Father. For you have nurtured us and strengthened us and given us a light on our path, guidance and strength when we had none. We thank you for our earthly fathers, for those who have mentored us and helped us with sage advice, with courageous examples, and a loving spirit. We pray that you would bless them all in this journey we call life. We pray for those within our community and those whom we love, many of whom are in difficult circumstances. We pray for them. We pray for those who celebrate this day, who have cause for joy in their lives, answered prayers, circumstances that have worked out well. We pray for them and would join them in their celebration. And now we pray for your light as we seek to discern what your word is saying to us this day, for you are still speaking, O God. Through Jesus the Christ we pray. Amen. Now, let me tell you why I rethought my sermon. It wasn't exactly a vision, but it was a thought that was in my head and in my heart that just wouldn't go away. And I thought about it in terms of what the gospel lesson, which I just read, had to say to us. And that thought that went in my head was not a happy one, but it was one that gave me pause to think. And it was the tragedy that was Jonestown. Many of us who were alive at that time, this is 35 years ago, in 1978, a charismatic preacher led a group of over 900 people from the streets of San Francisco to live in a community in Guyana. Jim Jones, an ordained pastor in the Christian Church Disciples of Christ, had gained a large following, mostly those who were either economically marginalized, forgotten, or a part of the large underbelly of that great American city, which is San Francisco. Jones spoke a message that somehow reached them and commanded their unwavering allegiance. Tragically, those devotees followed that egomaniacal leader into a mass suicide. And here we are 35 years later, and I believe that tragic instance in our history has many lessons for us. But as bad as it was, it provides for us an important help on the human journey. It is on one of those lessons that I want us to focus this morning. I want you to think with me about the hunger of the soul of those folks who followed Jones, even to death. I'm sure there were a variety of reasons that they had for following him, but a common
denominator of all of those was a deep hunger within their spirits for the something more in life. These people were some of the forgotten ones, but in this way, they speak for all of us. You see, I believe all human beings, no matter who you are, have a deep hole within your soul. It's how we are created. And we try to fill that hole within us with a whole lot of stuff that we are told will satisfy us and fill us to satisfaction. Some of that stuff is fairly obvious. Material things, for example. If you have enough financial security, we are told, you will find contentedness. You will be at peace. Throw in the right house, the right car, the right job, and you may feel you are doing a good job filling that hole. But it just doesn't work. The hole just doesn't seem to get any smaller. Well, what about relationships? Okay, so we go and search for good friends, a community maybe, and we may even find some good friends. That goes a long way. But you still feel there's something more to fill that need. Then there's that one significant relationship, that special someone whom we are told, if you find that one special relationship, that will do it. You may be blessed enough to find that significant other, someone who will provide the intimacy, the love, the acceptance that the human heart craves. But as wonderful as that relationship may be, it will never go to fill that hole. It's how we are made. That's what's going on in the gospel story here from Luke. This tender tale recalls two people who meet the Messiah. Simon the Pharisee, who hosts Jesus, and a woman of ill repute who is looking for a blessing. And the Pharisee invites Jesus into his home, but not because he is searching for that something more, but to look for a way to discredit the popular preacher. Because Jesus is a threat to all those in positions of power within the religious community. He doesn't even bother to extend the usual hospitality a host is expected to give to a house guest in that day, such as to wash the dust off the dirty feet of visitors. Not to do so was considered not just impolite, but it was really an insult. It was a transgression of the law of hospitality, which was a major part of the Jewish religion and tradition. And the Pharisee, who was an interpreter of the Jewish law, knew full well that this lack insulted Jesus. Was it intentional? We're not told. Maybe, maybe not. But he did it nevertheless. The woman, on the other hand, sneaks in uninvited and unwanted. She, in her courage, cares little what others think of her bravado. She has tried to fill that hole in her spirit with sexual liaisons, and has found those relationships wanting. She reminds me a little of Theresa Dunn, the real-life character whose life was the basis of Judith Rossner's novel, Looking for Mr. Goodbar. Dunn was a gifted special ed teacher who, for a variety of reasons, felt that great void in her life, a void that she tried to fill with one-night stands. Her life ends tragically in her death, in ironically what she had determined would be the last of those encounters. The unnamed woman in the gospel story had tried to fill her life in that same way. The more she drank from that cup, the emptier she felt. To her credit, she realized the folly of that way and came to the conclusion that her need was spiritual. Jesus probably was not the first rabbi that she may have sought out, but he was probably the first who would even let her near him. Others probably felt their reputation was on the line. If they even let a woman of her reputation near themselves, it would damage their reputation. But not Jesus. Jesus, as we see over and over in the Gospels, looked beyond a person's reputation to the spiritual hunger that he had the eyes to perceive and that drew her to seek him out. She somehow knew of his unconditional acceptance. She senses he knows her past and looks beyond it to the spiritual hunger that impelled her into his presence. She can feel that he realized the public humiliation that she risked just to come and be in his presence, not knowing whether he would accept her or not. Into a house where she knew she was neither welcome nor accepted. And so breaking through the crowd, breaking through those people who were the acceptable guests, enduring the stares of disgust and her not even caring at all, she rushes to his feet. She brought the most expensive thing that she had with her, the most precious possession she owned, a jar of expensive ointment she had planned to offer as a gift to this holy man, just in the hope that he would accept her. But she, at his feet, saw his dirty, dusty feet, and spontaneously she breaks open that jar and bathes his feet in that ointment. No one as wonderful as he should have to endure the indignity of such thoughtless lack of hospitality, she thought. She begins to weep as he does not turn away repulsed. As she performs this act of love and devotion, perhaps she cries because she has to endure the snide and cruel remarks of others who are watching this scene play out before them. Perhaps she's just overcome with the emotions that filled her heart. Whatever the case may be, her tears mingled with the ointment to wash his tired and dirty feet. Seeking the something more, she realized she has founded, as she anointed the feet of the Anointed One, the Messiah. This unnamed woman stands as a representative of each and every one of us.
Whether you are the one who has tried to find answers in all the wrong places, or whether you are one who has been shunned and marginalized, forgotten and unloved, or whether you are simply and desperately trying to fill the hole in your heart, this woman is our guide and our hope. No matter who you are, no matter where you are on life's journey, the journey inevitably must find its way to the feet of this Anointed One. For there you will find what will fill that hole. Thanks be to God. This lovely song is our response, and I think it is a very appropriate response to this story. It is found as an insert in your bulletin as the deer. So would you please stand if you are able?
You are Lord, my heart's desire and hope. The sparrow,
Almighty and everlasting God, we indeed thank you that you've been our father and our mother and our sister and our brother. You brought us to this place. You brought us to this moment. You have sought to fill our hearts and our hunger and our thirst. And you have done so. Having been blessed, we offer you these gifts. In thanksgiving, we offer you our lives as we go forth into the world to serve you and our neighbor in all that we do. Through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And now would you join me as we sing our closing hymn, Guide Me, O My Great Redeemer, number 436. Closing, I would invite those of you who seek the blessing of Holy Communion. The elements have been blessed. They will be here at the front, and you may come and take communion. You will not be able to miss Gordon. Secondly, I would also encourage you to stay for our fellowship hour in Pilgrim Hall and be present for that wonderful presentation as Joshua Tree presents to us their ministry of love and grace. And be there for the potluck and a wonderful presentation. And remember also, finally, that next week we will be blessing the water and the snacks which will be given out to those in need through Grace Lutheran. And now go forth into the world to serve God and your neighbor in all that you do. Go forth looking in the right places for the blessing of God. For it is at the feet of Jesus that you will find that which you truly crave and need. And as you go, may you have peace in your heart. Amen.